Thank you. Dear colleagues and friends, I want to speak about the process theory of physical illness, medicine, psychiatry. A shortest summary of what I want to say is in a quote from Aristotle, from the Anima. Ati, lohi, hanali, ise. A possible translation could be experiences or words in matter, or sufferings, pathos, pathology, or words in matter, in the body. Not just sufferings are in the body, but sufferings are words in the body. The central theme of my paper concerns the influence of psychological factors on the onset, the maintenance, and the cure of physical illness. I try to found this theoretically and with research findings. The process theory is a model that is broader than the mere physical explaining of becoming and being ill and of healing. It is a model that involves the role of the psychological agent. First, I want to say the core concept of the theory is the going together of what Janeling calls the old model and the new model. The old model of thinking is everything is separated in units. This thinking begins with the units. The new model tries to understand everything not in units, but in process terms. For example, implying and occurring. Janeling shows how the two models grow together as old model thinking in new model thinking. We will speak about the body as object, which is an example of the old model, and about the body as subject, the experiencing body, example of the new model. In his book, Phenomenology of Perception, Merleau-Ponty distinguishes the body object and the body subject. He devotes a chapter to the body as object and mechanistic physiology. He writes that I can only have knowledge of the body subject, I quote, by abandoning the body as an object and by going back to the body I experience at this moment. End of quote. He also says, the body object exists only conceptually. End of quote. The body subject is prior. It is the real body. The body object is an abstraction of it. The two bodies, so to speak, are the product of two approaches. The objectifying view and the subjectifying view, which is the matter in psychotherapy. Medicine looks at the body as an object, in the same manner as it looks at the machine. In the object model, everything is separated in parts and subparts. These parts, separate units, interact with each other. Air on one side and lungs on the other side are two separate things. They can interact with each other, but the relation they have is external. Just like the components of a machine do not have from themselves a relation with each other. Thinking this begins with the units. In this object model, one has a complete understanding of something. If one can take apart every component of it and then put them together again. But if we would do this with living organisms, they would die. Because the interaction first relation that the parts have with each other would be taken out of it. Life would be taken out of it. So they cannot be understood well in the object model. They need another approach. Another thinking were not the units or first, but the interaction. Their being in interaction precedes the parts or the units, for example, the cells, the skin, and so on. We can look at them as separate units, but without being involved in the process and sub-processes, the parts and units cannot even exist. In fact, they are sub-processes. For example, breathing is air coming into expanding lungs. Air coming in and expanding lungs cannot be separate. They are inextricable. They cannot even exist as units. The relation they have is internal. They have from themselves a relation with each other. So far the difference between an object and an organism. Now medicine. Medicine approaches the body as an object in which different parts and subparts can be seen. This consideration remains at the level of the tissues, the physical level. Tissues conceived as very complex objects. But a human being is more than tissues, and tissues are more than objects. We are tissues, we are plant bodies, we are behavior, animal bodies, and we are symbolic processes, human bodies. We are all this at the same time, in one event. For instance, I quote Jan Lin, when we write or speak, our bodies imply the next bit of muscle tissue process, which is also the behavior of our hands or lips and vocal cords, and also the next words, end of quote. In this example, you already see how the body object, the muscle process in my writing hand, and the body subject, the meanings that I write down, are inherent in each other. And you see that there are three levels, tissue, behavior, symbolic, inherently connected with each other. For example, when the doctor gives medication, he doesn't give it to a body object that is separate from the environment. The medication is not given to a sick brain or to sick lungs, but to an organism in interaction. Interaction at the three levels. An old example is LSD. LSD administered to somebody in isolation causes a bad trip. The same product in the same dose, given to the same person, but in an environment with friends, in a nice atmosphere, may bring a good trip. This is understandable from an interaction first process conception of the human being as a being in interaction with its environment on all levels. A human being is more than tissues that can become ill and can heal. First of all, a human being is a subject. I am my body. I am a body subject. Becoming ill is not merely something of the tissues, but something of the whole person. Body object and body subject are only two in our conceptualization. In reality, they are one. For example, I am in the kitchen. I have not eaten since a long time and I am hungry. But suddenly a very bad news comes in and my hunger disappears. It is the same body standing there in the kitchen with meanings overruling the physiological processes. Both views of the human body are necessary and they are not independent from each other. We can visualize them as follows. A square area surrounded by a white circle area. The square area is the straight approach of the body as object. here you have units first, mechanistic, objectifying, the sick body, the purely medical approach. The circle area is the whole approach of the body and subject. Here you have interaction first, process first, life, subjectifying, the sick person, the psychotherapeutic approach. Because the human body is first of all a body subject, and the body object does a reduction of it, the circle presents the wider area, encompassing the square area. Before we continue, let us look at some research data. I did a search in the medical literature for studies that may support the hypothesis in this paper. I don't have the means at the time for a systematic search, but still I collected more than 200 studies. I cannot present them here. Just a few examples. For example, a woman may suffer not only psychologically but also physically when she comes close to the date of her aborted fetus. Other findings, I just give a list, I just mention them shortly. After a history of a traumatic experience, there is 20% more risk for symptoms of angina pectoris, heart failure or a stroke. A pessimistic, explanatory style of a person appears to predict poor physical health at ages 45 through 60. Insecure attachment is found to occur frequently in patients with primary hypertension, almost twice as frequent as in non-clinical individuals. The meaning of an event can be so overwhelming that it causes sudden death. During the first days of the Gulf War in 1991, there was a sudden rise in the incidence of acute myocardial infarction and sudden death. A large study published in 2017 concerning almost 164,000 patients shows that psychological distress leads to an increased risk of death by cancer. Another research finding: in an experiment, rhinoviruses were dropped in the nose. The result was an infection from a cold if the stress of the participants was high, but no infection if it was low. In my search, I also wanted to find data that support the hypothesis that psychological factors may have an influence on the healing of a physical illness. Several studies show that a personal important date or occasion, important in the sense of getting attention, being at the center of attention, can have a strengthening effect on the will to live and can result in that the person postpones his or her death until after that date. There are studies that show that psychotherapy or elements of psychotherapy can change gene expression, such that it has a positive effect on physical health. Writing therapy can lead to positive changes in the immune system. And the more this writing is experiential, the greater this effect. This means that working at the level of meanings and meaning unfolding, which is the area of the body subject, can have an effect on the body object. Some people may now think we can act directly on the body object and introduce these changes in the immune system with medication. But then the whole process of the body subject is left out. Because then the writing and the unfolding of meanings by this has not been able to take place, which is a process for which the body needs language or another symbolization. It is an error to think that a pharmacological intervention and a psychotherapeutic intervention can lead to the same effect. In a meta-analysis of 34 randomized controlled trial studies about the influence on the immune system of mind-body therapies, including Tai Chi, Qigong, meditation and yoga, it is concluded that mind-body therapies may reduce inflammation. This is a physical effect. Another study shows that transcendental meditation, a mind-body intervention, with patients with heart failure can lead, among others, to significant amelioration on the 6-minute walk test, thus an effect in the physical area. German cardiologists say, I quote, psychosocial interventions have shown positive effects partially also on the cardiovascular morbidity and mortality, end of quote. In the consensus of the German Society for Cardiology, a class 1 and evidence level A recommendation, which is the highest level in evidence-based medicine, is given for the need to look at psychosocial risk factors in the evaluation of coronary risks. Okay, so far some data, you know. Now the question is, how can we understand this data? We can have an effect on the body via both areas. Not only physical and chemical factors, the square area, but also meanings, the circle area, have an effect on the body. That meanings have an effect on the body is well known. But how can we understand that meanings can have an effect on the body? So let us look first at the effect of a healthy influence of meanings on the body and a process explanation of it. How the body subject initiates meaning and can then develop it to an implicit meaning and can resolve it in a felt shift. All three these moments of the experiential change step have an effect on the body object. The process event of an experiential change step, which is an event of the body subject, has an effect on the body object. It has physical effects. It has physical effects which can be measured and objectified. Such moments of meaning formation and bodily relief are crucial for a psychotherapeutic approach to be effective. Psychotherapeutic interventions are directed to the circle area, namely the field of the body subject, and this encompasses the body object. In fact, it is the same body. We see here that a psychotherapeutic effect on the body subject is also an effect on the body object. We have seen how meaning is processed and the healthy, relieving influence of it on the body. Now, what happens when meaning processing doesn't succeed and when the implied process, the implied steps or the intentionality cannot go on? And what is the effect of this on the body? First, let us look a little bit closer at the three moments in the meaning processing. Before the person lets form an implicit meaning of a problem, the meaning that the problem situation has for him is in some way already in the body. Already some meaning processing has initiated. This is the moment of the process before the implicit meaning. Namely, when the body is affected by the situation, but the person may not be aware of it, or may not pay attention to it. The person is not yet focusing and does not yet have the implicit meaning. He does not yet have knowing that he is affected. We could call this manner in which the body is meaning pre-implicit or unconscious. This manner can stay there, blocked for a long time. If the person does not let form an implicit meaning of it, it stays there as a meaning tendency. This is the first manner in which the person has or rather is the problem. Let us call it the one manner. When a person directs his attention to it and the direct reference forms, then he has the problem as an implicit feeling, the two manner. This is a further forming. The meaning tendency is formed further to an implicit meaning. And after the explication of it, a person has the problem in the form of a solved problem, the three manner. We also can name the three moments of meaning processing: meaning tendency, implicit meaning, and explicit meaning. Now, what remains in the one manner expresses itself in the body subject and in the body object. So meaning processings don't succeed. This will express itself in the body subject and lead to structure-bound behavior patterns. When the processing of meaning remains in the one manner of the body subject, this will also express itself in the body object. Chen Lin says, the unconscious consists of the body's stopper processes, the muscular and visceral blockages. He also says, the unconscious of the body, end of quote. When a meaning tendency remains unprocessed, then it can be translated physiologically. The body is a monument of its problems. But often it seems that psychological dysfunctioning takes place in the sense of takes a place in a certain area of the body. The lungs, for example, in asthma. Another example is blockage of the hand in not being able to put one's signature on something. This blockage is not physically caused by an anatomical defect or a paralysis. The blockage is physical, but it is mentally or psychologically caused. But we cannot conceptualize this causation as that the mind uses the anatomical hand to be able or not to be able to put the signature. Because then we are again in the dualism. No. Just like the body object is not used as instrument by the body subject, but also is the body subject, the hand is not the instrument of the mind, the hand is not the means that is used by the mind, the hand is immediately mental. Here we also think of Merleau-Ponty's example, where he says about the capacity of blind typing, I quote, "It is knowledge in the hands," end of quote. The hand is part of the mental, or the hand participates in the mental, in the intentionality. So the blockage of the intentionality may seem to take a place in a particular area of the body, a member, an organ. The meaning cluster which searches for expression remains blocked, and this one manner centers itself as it were in the stomach, or in the hand, or in the skin, for example the skin. For example, patients with alopecia areata, which is hair loss, a particular spot, baldness, or bald spots on the scalp. Patients with alopecia reported twice as much psychotraumas than a control group of patients who consulted for skin surgery. This is research done by a dermatologist who integrates hypnotherapy in her treatments. In a pilot study of patients with extensive alopecia, which remained resistant to the usual medical treatment, a number of hypnotherapy sessions was added to this treatment. And the result that 12 of the 21 patients showed significant new hair growth. Now, what can we learn from the circle area about physical illness? We can start an understanding of a physical illness from a process theory viewpoint with the following question. What do we see when we look at physical illness through the circle area? Because that illness is also in the circle. Looking through the circle at the physical illness, we look at it through the facets of the circle area. Interaction first, life, subject, being, intentionality, situations, meaning, therapy directed to being, the physical illness, and so on. In the circle area, we find the subject. And subject is being, not just having. The experience I have a cold is different from the experience in a certain way I am a cold. I am ill with a cold, as English language says. When I have cancer in a certain way, I am cancer. I am ill with cancer. Having cancer is also a specific being. Illness is something of the circle area. The body seen as purely mechanistic, as purely an object, in fact cannot fall ill. This is because an object cannot fall ill. Therefore we speak of body object in body subject, before the split. In considering physical illness we cannot but start with the circle area. Only the circle area can fall ill. Here we must see two things. First, tissues are also in the circle area because they are embedded in interaction first processes. And second, in the circle area, tissues, behavior and symbolic processes are inherent in each other, as we have seen above in the example of writing. A change in one is a change in the other two. This is why the body subject who is ill with cancer may benefit from psychotherapy also in its tissues, as well as it needs chemical, radioactive means to improve. Other example, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, COPD. I have COPD versus I am COPD. People with COPD have very deep difficulty to breathe. For these patients, it is not so that their lungs are ill while as a subject they are healthy. It affects their being. Their way of living has deeply changed. Next to the physical facets of the disease, in a certain way, they are COPD. Just as the hand in the example above is too roughly permeated with mind, here the person's being is too roughly permeated by the physical illness. This is an example of a physical illness affects the being of the person. Besides looking through the circle at having and being the illness, it may be interesting to look through the circle for causes and for treatments. Research shows that interventions directed to the body subject may be effective for physical manifestations of COPD. Next, to look into the circle that having and being the illness is very interesting to look to for causes and for treatments. Research shows that interventions directed to the body subject may be effective for COPD. Now, the example of alopecia. We are used to look at it only through the square area. But if we look at alopecia through the circle area, we find suffering at the subject level, we find trauma in the history, and we find the positive effect of it on of hypnotherapy. This is an example of the being of the person affects the physical illness. The being traumatized correlates with or partly causes the physical illness, and therapy of the trauma ameliorates the physical illness. Alopecia is shown here as an example of the body subject and the body, is an example of the body object and the body subject going together. We want to understand this going together and find a way of using both of them. We will see that this will be a back and forth. Let us look theoretically at this going together along the following steps, theoretically or philosophically. I just will mention the steps. One process is first, units come from it. Two, interaction first thinking is prior to units first thinking, but both are important. Three, the two help each other to make progress. For example, applying concepts and techniques in psychotherapy can be helpful, but always happens in reference to the implicit layer in the client. Four, both are important, not separate as two next to each other, but in a unity, old model in new model. Five, both the order of units and the process order must work together in the back and forth. For example, we understand a difficult text better after reading it many times. Thus, by going back and forth many times between the text and our understanding, the explicit side remains fixed, but the implicit load is growing. Jen Lin writes, at the end of an important article, the responsive order, human beings can be understood by moving back and forth between the logical and the responsive order. End of quote. Let us paraphrase this sentence too. Sick human beings can be understood by moving back and forth between the logical and the responsive order. And six, when we speak of back and forth, then the next question is, when do the transitions between the two come? Taking into account the 2 hours in medicine means moving back and forth between body object and body subject, with each time the body subject is the most basic. Let us look at the contact of a doctor with a sick person. There are 2 ways to start the contact. The usual way is that the doctor collects information by listening to the complaints and asking questions. That he does a clinical examination of the patient. And if necessary, laboratory and technical investigations. And then that he makes a diagnosis. This is the objectifying approach. What we plead for here is that the doctor starts by listening experientially to the person and to his being ill, and that he helps him to deepen his experiential speaking, and when it is necessary that he makes space, and when it is necessary that he makes space within this kind of contact for the objectifying approach. And after that, he can return to the subjectifying attitude. This is the medical and psychotherapeutic approach. The psychotherapeutic approach is the most basic. How can we in practice carefully preserve the findings of medicine and at the same time bring in the treatment the experiencing of the patient and the healing power that can come from there? Formulated in the form of our thesis here, the question becomes how to bring in medical interventions in the psychotherapeutic approach of a patient suffering, for example, from stomach cancer. In a psychotherapeutic approach of the person suffering from stomach cancer, we have to find ways of opening the search for possible meanings about this person with this being ill. We have to find ways of opening the search for possible meanings about how this person with this being ill is involved in his life. This side, the experiential side of the doctor-patient contact, is not directed to the stomach cancer or to a fixed meaning of it, not to the having stomach cancer, but to the being stomach cancer, to the being ill with stomach cancer. It is directed to the situations of the patient, to the possible past implying and the actual and future experienced implying of the stomach cancer. Possibly there is a past implying that became fixed in the stomach cancer, just like as we saw a past psychotrauma can become fixed in alopecia. Understanding stomach cancer from that point of view implies the broader model. The findings of classical medicine about this being ill and its recovery are put within this broader model. We must address the stomach cancer of the patient both as body object, medication and other physical means, and as body subject, psychotherapy. Thus the problem is posed of the mutual transition between both approaches. So, when and how to make the transitions? The first question is, in the concrete contact with the patient, when and how must we make a transition from the mere medical approach directed at the body object to the psychotherapeutic approach directed to the body subject? One answer is, each time we see and feel that the medical model does not have an answer for the more that is happening, we must be open for it more. This is the point where the wider model comes to the fore. Second question, when I hope to make the transition from the psychotherapeutic to the medical approach. We can make this transition each time the situation asks for old model handling, the mere medical acting. For example, when a patient has cut his wrists, the first thing to do is not a psychotherapeutic session of listening and helping the person focus, but to stop the bleeding, bring him to the hospital, give him new blood, and suture the wounds, and then listen and help focusing. Some other examples of the transitions. With a patient with cancer, the doctor addresses the illness itself, where it is localized, which kind of cancer it is, how far it is evolved, the metastasis, and so on. But it is good at the same time, and not afterwards, to have an eye for the patient as person. What is going on in his experience? It is good to follow it attentively. When the patient during the encounter shows a sign of distress, even the smallest one, the doctor tries to tune in to what the patient is experiencing. Another example where the medical exploration gives precedence to the experiential exploration. Client says, since 2 months, my menses returned after they stayed away during 6 months. It's confusing for me. The doctor, after a short silence, says, you don't understand it well. In the usual medical contact, the doctor would ask some further questions about the menses themselves, and eventually he would say, we will examine it. Here the doctor takes another direction. First, he waits a while to see if the patient spontaneously makes more clear something about this confusing. And then he gives it back in reflection, as an invitation to examine it further. He clearly gives precedence to the experiential exploration. 11 exchanges further, the client says, in the menopause, the being feminine was gone a bit. Now it is back. And somewhat later, she says, maybe it happens because the last year we had much less sex. First, it was once in a month. Now, once in 2 or 3 months. Not that I don't have need for it. It is my husband. End of the transcript. At this point, the session takes about 10 minutes, and we see that the patient already can go deeply in such a short while. That makes it possible to fit it in the medical consultation. The doctor first helps this short piece of process to occur, and after that, he can examine medically the possible physical problem with the menses. In this way, the dealing with physical illnesses is the best that the going back, in this way of dealing with physical diseases, it is best that the going back and forth between the medical approach and the psychotherapeutic approach is done by the same person, the doctor. It is best that it is done by the same person so that the patient actually experiences an approach that unifies body and mind. That he experiences no separation of physical body and experiencing body. Each doctor should have the basic psychotherapeutic skills. I played for a thorough psychotherapy training as part of medicine training itself, and already there integrated with the physical approach. Of course, this is not arguing against the many psychotherapists who are not a medical doctor. On the contrary, they are badly needed. My plea is for a wider treatment of patients with physical complaints and illnesses, a treatment that consists of a particular medico-psychotherapeutic combination that needs somebody who is trained in both and can go back and forth between both. Transition. Let us go back to in particular the transitions to the more, to the wider model. One way towards the transition is to look where the medical approach has shortcomings in its practice. For example, discovering that talking with a patient about the causes of his depression brings little or no change. What medicine does not tend to do at such a point is pausing. Pausing at a specific shortcoming is going to the experiential level of this point, to let the felt sense for. At that point, we feel the wider order, and from the felt sense, we can the wider order let do its work. In this way, we come in the wider order of medicine, from where a change of it can come. Another way towards the transition is to look where the mechanistic model has shortcomings in its explanation, for example, of the placebo effect. What the placebo effect, a pill with the same color, the same taste, the same form, but without the pharmacological effective chemical, gives the same effect in a certain percentage of the patients. what the placebo effect concerns, medical theory concerns it as a contamination of their pure model, as kind of a pollution. It doesn't fit the model. But the sound scientific attitude means the following. If you approach a piece of reality with a certain model, and that reality responds in a manner that doesn't fit your model, then you may not put aside that reality as something strange or try to adapt that reality to your model, but you must reconsider your model. This is what followers of the medical model don't want, or they are not able to do it, or they don't dare to look at what the placebo effect really means. Namely, that the classical medical model cannot explain this. They don't have the courage to look. In this respect, a new Vesalius is needed, says Jan Hendrik van den Berg, a Dutch phenomenological psychiatrist. Vesalius discovered the anatomy because he didn't turn away his head. And in contrast with his scientist predecessors, he did have the courage to look at the reality of the dead bodies, instead of staying with the handbooks. He did dare to look and to see, and he did dare to go counter to the faults and mistakes that medicine had copied from its authorities for more than 1,000 years. In that way, he was able to pull out the impersonal from the personal. The impersonal being namely the anatomy, the building of the body, the fabrica, as it is called in the title of his work, De Humani Corporis Fabrica. Nowadays, says Van den Berg, the problem is the other way around, namely to pull out the personal from the impersonal. He writes, our current mode of existence is bad insofar it imprisons the personal between two impersonal powers, the internal domain of the anatomical and the external domain of the technical equipment. Now a new Vesalius is needed, a new Vesalius who, like the famous old one, doesn't turn away the head. Although it is not simple, in the midst of a world which massively adores the impersonal as a holy thing, it is not simple to restore the single, individual, implacable person. End of quote. So what medicine today requires is a new Vesalius who does have the courage to look. We said nature responds in a strange way. Here, strange means not understandable in the prevalent terms of current medicine. In other words, nature responds in a way that is broader than is expected by the order of current medicine. This broader order is the responsive order, as Jenning calls it. The reality of health and illness has a response which appeals for more than the unit's first model that has elicited that response. But medicine simply continues with the same model. For example, with the patient with illness phobia, many doctors continue with the same kind of answer. They keep doing examinations and blood tests in order to exclude any possible physical illness, and they don't come to a therapeutic speaking. But if one cannot lay hold of the mind behind these complaints, then this is the consequence of only staying in the basic attitude of classical medicine and of continuing to look at this kind of problems merely from the unit's first thinking, and in this way maintaining them. Thus, what is needed is that medicine changes its model. What this medicine has found and discovered must be preserved. But it must be fitted in another thinking and in another practice of dealing with illness and healing. healing not only as a result of a physical chemical means, but also of psychotherapy. Then it will also be possible to come to a new broader model of illness. Thank you.